3D prints have a huge weakness, and this is that they are strong if they are loaded along their layers, but often significantly weaker if you load them in between their layers. Some materials like ABS can be glued together by solvents. So what happens when we brush some acetone onto each printed layer before the next one starts? Can we glue layers together that way to create perfectly strong 3D prints? Let's find out more. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan and welcome to CNC Kitchen. This video is sponsored by Prusa Research with their original Prusa i3 Mark 3S Plus and printables.com, the go-to website for high-quality 3D models. More on them later. Filament-based 3D printing is a great technology, not only for prototypes, but also for real functional parts. Though one of the great weaknesses of these prints is that due to the layer-by-layer manufacturing approach, the individual extrusions usually don't perfectly adhere to each other, which is making parts significantly weaker in this direction. There are ways to increase layer adhesion, like higher extrusion temperatures, slower printing speeds, less cooling enclosures, or just selecting a material that performs better in this regard. But still, the holy grail of filament-based 3D printing is creating parts that are equally strong regardless of the printing orientation. If you have kids at home that play with Lego or Duplo, you might be aware that if these parts break, the best way to glue them together is to just brush acetone on the fracture surfaces and push them together. Most Lego parts are made from ABS, which is dissolved by acetone, and when it evaporates again, creates a joint almost as strong as the initial part. I already tested in the past if acetone-smoothed ABS and isopropyl alcohol-smoothed PVB are stronger than regular parts, and if you want to see the results, check out the linked video. But what myself, and I think even many of you have been already asking yourselves, is if we could increase layer adhesion of ABS prints if we would simply brush a bit of solvent onto every printed layer to create a perfect bond when the subsequent one is printed on top. And so that you don't have to try it out, I sat hours and hours in front of my 3D printer, brushing acetone onto every layer to find out if this method works or not. If you appreciate my work and dedication I put into projects like this, then consider leaving a like and subscribing to the channel for more interesting tests like this one. Before we try out this method, let's first test the strength of parts printed flat and those printed upright. This will give us a reference that we can use to compare our solvent bonding techniques against. For the horizontal specimens, I used the standard dog bone samples printed with 6 perimeters so that all of the printed lines are oriented in the loading direction. The standing parts are round layer adhesion samples that are printed with 100% infill and only 1 perimeter. For a more real-life part, I chose my test hook printed with 2 perimeters and 30% infill, printed horizontally and standing on the bed of my Prusa Mark 3S. As a first material, I tried regular ABS because smoothing and bonding that with acetone is very common. Once the parts were printed, I put them one after another into my DIY universal test machine and slowly pulled them until they broke. I tested at least 3 samples per orientation to get some idea about the variability of the results. I measured each sample before the test to accurately take the cross-section into consideration. The horizontal dog bone samples were able to bear 41 megapascals of stress on average and all failed with a really mesmerizing whitening pattern. The layer adhesion samples, on the other hand, were only able to bear 19 megapascals until they failed, which is less than half of the material strength, but honestly more than I would have expected with ABS, because that's often really bad in layer adhesion when printed without an enclosure. Maybe the 30 degrees Celsius I had in my office from time to time helped here. Let's also take a look at my test hook that I used to represent a more real-life part and use case. The ones printed flat were able to bear 35 kilograms of load before failure. The standing ones, unfortunately, only a disappointing 6 kilograms. Though this isn't unexpected with ABS, especially since I had to use a tiny bit of cooling to print the overhangs. On the other hand, maybe the solvent bonding technique can really shine here. Before I tried solvent bonding of a whole part, I wanted to find out what the strength of a single bond is. I simply used the already broken layer adhesion samples, soaked the fracture surfaces in acetone, and firmly pushed them together after a couple of seconds. In the beginning, the glued sections are still sticky and soft, and it takes a bit until the solvent evaporates to establish the full strength of the bond. To speed up this process, I put the parts for 24 hours at 60 degrees Celsius into my dehydrator. When testing the samples, 2 of 3 didn't break at the bond but next to it, which shows that the strength of the ABS bond is at least as good as the normal layer adhesion. One of the samples unfortunately broke directly at the glued section, maybe because I didn't properly push the parts together or fully evaporated the solvent. Anyways, on average the parts still were able to bear 17 megapascals before failure and fall within the scatter band of the tests. So let's get to full solvent bonding. My first idea was to build a contraption for my E3D tool changer, where I have one tool with a brush that automatically adds the solvent onto each layer after it was printed. But since I didn't even know if the new method worked out, I thought I'd rather make a proof of concept and brush the acetone onto each layer manually. I added a short layer change G-code in Prusa Slicer, where the print head moves to the side, and using M0 waits until I'm finished and push the button next to the screen again. Sounds straightforward. Unfortunately, as it turned out, it wasn't that easy. Acetone has a quite low boiling point, so if the previous layer is still warm, it directly boils off. If you get it to stay on the surface, it will soak into the material and cause that to foam up a little as soon as the hot new layer gets printed. I was able to partially get around these problems by using the part cooling fan at full blow and also reducing the extrusion factor quite significantly to only 80-85%. Once I figured that out, the real boring part started, and that was sitting in front of the printer for 2-3 hours for each set of samples, brushing acetone onto each of the 130 layers. A good thing that I started to learn a bit of Japanese, so I used the time to learn my hiragana and katagana characters. In the end, the samples turned out okay. Sometimes the nozzle really dug through the material, resulting in plastic being dragged out to the sides, but in general, the acetone made the parts look really shiny. Printing the test hook worked better because since I only had 2 parameters in sparse infill, the material that swole up from the acetone could just squeeze out to the sides, interfering less with the printing process. While the parts are in the dehydrator for 24 hours to remove the remaining solvent, let's quickly talk about today's video sponsor, which is Prusa Research with their Prusa Mark 3S Plus and their model sharing website printables.com. Printables is one of the best 3D model sharing websites out there, with an awesome user experience featuring helpful filters, and it's just snappy to use on any device. The best thing, it's free and can be used by anyone to download models and also share your designs, even if you don't have a Prusa printer. You should definitely give it a try, because not only can you already find a huge selection of models there, but if you previously hosted your designs on Thingiverse, you can automatically migrate them and earn rewards like free filament and resin that way. You can also submit your designs to the regular contests where you can win amazing prizes. And I can't talk about a Prusa product without mentioning their Prusa i3 Mark 3S Plus. I have a ton of printers in my studio, but my Mark 3 has been and still is my workhorse printer that simply works even after thousands of hours of printing. And that without any modifications and tinkering necessary. With Prusa Slicer and all the built-in profiles, it's fire and forget for me. I can start a print, leave the room and know that a day later I'll have a finished print on the print bed, which makes working with it so effective. So if you are looking for a 3D printer that just works, is a tool and not the project itself, check out the original Prusa Mark 3S Plus using the link below. And if you're looking for models to print or share your own designs, then check out printables.com. Let's now get back to the layer bonded samples and see if the acetone was able to bond the layers together. The samples didn't directly fall apart, but their strength unfortunately was still significantly worse than the one printed as one piece. The average strength was only 6 megapascals and therefore only around 15% of the reference strength. A bit disappointing, to be honest. The fracture surfaces also looked very much like the unbonded ones, only with a bit of shininess of the acetone. Interestingly enough, I personally would have expected that they broke within the section that swelled up more, and where the nozzle dug through the material, but those sections seem to be stronger. Maybe the nozzle textured the layers so that bonding is better. And this is probably also the right point to ask you for your ideas on how you think layer adhesion could be improved besides the usual slicer settings. Could we texture or stitch layers together in some way? Would that require an external tool, or could this be handled by the slicer itself? Please comment your ideas below to discuss them, and maybe I can try out some of them. The layer bonder test hook, on which I had significantly fewer printing problems, also didn't increase in strength, and it failed just like the reference samples at only 6 kilograms. So wait, we're not done yet. There's another material that's commonly smoothed with solvents and therefore can also be glued, which is PVB. Some of you might know that under the name PolySmooth, where PolyMaker made it popular with their PolySmoother. PVB is soluble in isopropyl alcohol instead of acetone, which makes smoothing way more comfortable. Isopropyl alcohol is also volatile, flammable, and is not the best thing to breathe, but due to its high low boiling point, easier and safer to work with. So I again printed flat dog bone samples and standing layer adhesion samples as a reference and tested them for their strength. PVB is primarily not used for its mechanical properties, but rather for its smoothability and therefore either decorative parts or prints that need to hold liquids and gases. Still, in terms of strength, it was very similar to ABS with 42 megapascals failure stress on average, but a way more ductile behavior than ABS. Whereas ABS broke quickly after yielding, the PolySmooth just stretched and stretched. Layer adhesion was very similar and the samples broke at around 45% of the reference stress. Printing the layer bonded PVB samples worked out significantly better than with ABS and acetone, probably because with the draft shield printing first, I was able to evaporate more of the isopropyl alcohol before I printed the next layer. So a handful of katakana letters later, I finally had my IPA bonded PolySmooth samples. Compared to the acetone samples, these ones felt really soft after the process and probably absorbed quite a lot of solvent during printing. I put them together with the samples that I simply glued in the middle for 48 hours into my dehydrator to get them back to their regular hardness. The first results on the universal test machine were not super promising because the glued samples were already weaker than the reference layer adhesion samples and all broke right at the seam. The solvent bonded samples were a bit stronger but still didn't reach the strength values of the reference. So there we have it. Even though layer bonding sounds very exciting, it's not as simple as it would seem, and my first proof of concept results were not very promising. I'm not saying that my process was perfect, because it wasn't automated, and maybe even after 2 days in such a dehydrator, not all the solvent might have been removed from the samples. But would such a method really be feasible if you had to force dry parts for several days or even weeks after printing them? I wouldn't call solvent bonding dead. But there needs to be more detailed investigations. Have I used the right solvent? Might they even harm the material at these temperatures and concentrations? Or would glue even work better? In a way, I'm also happy that the results were not overwhelming because, to be honest, in its current state, it's not only tedious to apply, but also having flammable solvents next to very hot components just screams for severe safety hazards. Still, I think it's important to also publish negative findings like this one, even though they are not groundbreaking, because I can satisfy my and your curiosity, and they can help others to not follow similar paths in the future or improve on the things that didn't work. In the end, we should rather try to come up with different methods to improve strength of our 3D printed parts. There's still so much untouched potential in software and slicers where we need ideas and proof of concept to give an incentive to developers to implement them. So please keep your ideas coming. Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you found this video interesting. If you want to support my work, head over to Patreon or become a YouTube member. Also, check out the other videos in my library. I hope to see you in the next one. Auf Wiedersehen and goodbye. To compare our solvent bonding techniques.